So I'm Nancy Emery, and I'm the co-PI with the Niwot Ridge LTER. I am excited to be here to represent Niwot and talk about human-environment interactions in this Alpine system. I have two quick site updates that I want to share. First, Eve Hinckley, an environmental biogeochemist at CU Boulder and longtime researcher with Niwot, has rotated on as a co-PI on our team. And in partnership with the Department of Ecology and Evolutionary Biology at CU Boulder, we have recently received an interdisciplinary graduate education award from NSF. And this award is supporting the development and testing of an intervention program that aims to reduce barriers to graduate school for students from groups that are underrepresented in the field-based sciences. We call it Fired Up, and I'd be really excited to discuss this further during any of our breaks. So Niwot Ridge is perched at over 3,500 meters in elevation in the southern Rocky Mountains. It runs right up to the Continental Divide. It falls within the traditional lands of the Ute, Arapaho, and Cheyenne people. Today, it is part of the City of Boulder watershed, and it remains a relatively remote and protected site. This does not mean it is shielded from human impacts and interactions. Like many alpine regions, Niwot has experienced sharp increases in mean temperatures over the past several decades, especially since 1980, shown in red here. However, we are not yet seeing an earlier end to the snow season, like many of the alpine regions in Western North America, though models predict that this is likely to change in the near future. So a major focus of recent and future research at Niwot is understanding the impacts of human-mediated warming on this system and the ecosystem services the system provides. So recent analyses of our long-term records at Niwot have linked warming temperatures to major physical changes in the system. For example, on the left here, the ice-free period in five of the alpine lakes that we monitor on the ridge has increased by an average of 24 days since 1983. On the right, I'm showing patterns we have seen where levels of sulfate is increasing in stream flow. And these patterns are consistent with temperature-mediated increases in bedrock weathering and potentially the melting of permafrost and rock glaciers. A major goal of our team right now is to identify and explain the biological and ecosystem consequences of warming and associated physical changes like those shown here. Rapid warming is an ongoing extreme event in this and other alpine systems where many of the species are very long-lived and slow-growing and may be particularly vulnerable to rapid change. One particularly striking observation from our long-term data is the high amount of variation we observe in if and how fast organisms are responding to warming, indicating that some components of this system will be more vulnerable to climate change than others. To provide an example of this, I'm showing you some contrasting trends in alpine tundra plant community responses to warming in terms of productivity on the left, richness in the middle, and species composition on the right over 30 years of vegetation data that we've collected at the site. These are analyses that our project coordinator, Dr. Megan Oldfather, has been leading over the past few months. Each figure shows responses in each of five community types listed on the right there, all of which occur within the tundra at Niwot. Statistically significant trends are represented by the solid lines. These three panels illustrate how communities are varying in the magnitude, rate, and type of responses they are showing to increasing temperatures. Finally, if we characterize each species by the degree to which they are warm adapted or cool adapted, we observe variation among communities in the extent to which they are becoming dominated by warmer or cooler species, which we call thermophilization. These observations in the tundra are paralleled by other systems at Niwot and have prompted two main questions that we are preparing to address next as we're gearing up to submit a renewal in spring. The questions can be summarized as number one, what causes this variation in responsiveness to rising temperatures? And second, how does that variation shape ecosystem processes at individual locations in the landscape, and then when aggregated across complex landscapes? By addressing these questions at Niwot, we aim to contribute to a broader movement in ecology that is shifting from trying to predict the potential states of systems under climate change to understanding what determines the rates of responsiveness. And alpine systems provide a particularly powerful context for teasing apart the roles of biotic and abiotic constraints in driving ecological and ecosystem level responses to temperature. Thank you.